thank you, thank you, thank you for joining as we kick off this webinar series. This is the first one. The second one is Why Philanthropy is Failing to Miss the Mark. But I'm hoping for this time that we have together, this really is more of a training. It's a mini training, and it's a training that I've given over the years with national nonprofits that I'm summarizing in about an hour of a presentation. And I'm sure there will be one or two nuggets that you can take away as we all are growing during this very challenging and yet changing philanthropic landscape. So I'm happy to see some folks that are new and old, folks that I haven't met before, that we're gonna become fast friends, and folks that I've worked with over the years. So thank you so much for joining. I want to thank our sponsor, and I'll kick that off, Pinnacle Talent Acquisition, who is sponsoring not only this, but our next upcoming webinar, which is next on the 25th. And again, that's Why Philanthropy is Failing. And again, you know, this really is for content sharing. It's really to lift all boats in the marketplace, lift all that we are all riding a different tide because things have just turned on their head. So I would be remiss again if I did not thank Pinnacle Talent Acquisition. They have been an amazing partner supporting this and upcoming webinar series. And the next one, as I mentioned, will focus on the five key tactics that are cost-neutral tools that nonprofits and for-profits can do together. So Pinnacle Talent Acquisition is an HR staffing and DEI service organization. They build culture, and knowing that the internal cultures of organizations have changed drastically, we want to make sure that we are putting the right people on the bus so that we are, again, making partnership development easier, because if you have the right team in leadership and the right team in development, everything is a bit easier. So the core purpose of DiCam Strategic Solutions is to develop nonprofit and for-profit partnerships for sustained social impact. I work in key areas such as systems, people, and environmental. However, my team crosses other areas as well. I work with nonprofits on fund development strategies, training, mindset coaching, and plan development. And with for-profit partners on partnership development, bringing new people to them, bringing new nonprofits to them, a new portfolio, grantee training, and ideation to go deeper with their nonprofit partners. I'm hearing from a lot of partners these days that they want to go deeper, but they really don't know how to go deeper. So I am there to help them focus on what's important of having a strengthening partnership. In my 25 years experience of leading as a chief development officer with some of the nation's largest foundations, I personally closed over $130 million and managed teams to secure close to $500 million. And in this function, I've served as that hub, that glue, linking the nation's largest philanthropic organizations and Fortune 100 companies with both very complex strategic partnerships, from social enterprises, white labels, profit sharing, to simple events and sponsorships. So why this session? In my work with local and national nonprofits, I have seen firsthand the struggles and was shocked with how many went out of business during COVID. It actually hurt my heart. You know, some ones that really needed to be there in the marketplace to solve some of the social issues that we were facing were now faced with closing their doors. So nonprofits are struggling to remain relevant. And if I can help sustain key resources and share my expertise to lift all boats, that's why I'm here. So the session outcome is simple. Increase your ratio from the 1 in 10 or 1 in 15, meaning the number of proposals that you write to the number of proposals that are awarded, to a 1 in 3, and to go deeper with your clients and partners. And though I do have a 1 in 3 ratio, best believe those other 2 or 3 are funding something, whether it's a conference or thought leadership or something of that sort. So I'm going to pause here to do a quick poll to see who is in the room. Hold on 1 minute. There we go. Launch poll. So I want to know who's here. So if you could click on and vote, if you're nonprofit leader, C-suite, nonprofit development, you're the program marketing side, your grant making entity, leadership or program, or others. So click on the poll to the right. It's the square, or it should just come up. Christina, do you see the poll?
Yes, I do see the poll.
Okay, good. Great. So
a little notification that pops up. If everyone would just click on it, then the poll will show.
All right. Pia says she does not see it. All right. Okay. I see folks are voting already.
Have to click on the bottom right. There's an image of a triangle, a square, and a circle. If you click on that, you'll then get a link to the poll.
Thank you. Thank you. So again, that's the bottom right, all the way to the corner. There's a triangle, a square, and a circle. Click on that, and then the poll will come up. All right, nonprofit development, leadership, others. All right, good. I just want to make sure I know who I'm talking to so that I can tailor my my examples to who's in the room. So it's mostly development folks and some leaders and general partnership interests. Okay, got it. So what this does is it helps me think through, you know, not only what I need to talk about with you, but using some specific examples. Hi, Brenda, thanks so much for joining. We're already in the discussion, so thank you again. But as we know, and as we've seen since January 2020, this version of philanthropy is different. So it's going to take more than development. It's going to take the organization to change in order to still remain relevant. I can personally say that I have been humbled and proud to be a part of this time in history of nonprofits and funding entities truly focusing on bridging the equity gap. And I will say it 1,000 times, and I literally say it on every call that I have with grant-making organizations. It is their job as philanthropy to bridge equity. It's their job. So we have to, again, you know, keep that drumbeat going. We've had some amazing star players in this space, such as Salesforce, and PayPal, JP Morgan, Bank of America, that have really invested some serious dollars. So, you know, but with all this comes organizational mindset shift. Folks don't want the same widget, gidget, gadget that you all were selling before. They're really looking for partnerships that need systematic impact. So hopefully you'll get a tool or two to help you think through and have a mindset shift moving forward. Okay, next slide. There we go. I would be remiss if I did not bring up National Nonprofit Day, which was on Tuesday. So whoop whoop to the nonprofits. But also, if you've seen in some of my posts, I celebrated Black Philanthropy Month. Yep, that's actually a thing. It's been around for about 10 years. And it's recognized in about 30 countries. And it really is a time to galvanize, give back, and recognizing donors in the variety of ways that Black Americans and Blacks have given, whether they're large gifts or the volumes of small gifts that are given to Black families, churches, and civic organizations. You know, I was reading an article and it said, according to the African American Psychology 4th edition in 2019, Black households tend to give more of their discretionary income, as much as 25% more, to charitable causes than any other segment in society. 25% more. So for the development folks that are focused on major gifts, do you have a strategy that's focusing on African Americans and Black Americans, or if you're international, as I said, it's in 30 countries, of how to engage them into your charitable giving. And this, it stems back generations, whether it's Madam C.J. Walker or Black Wall Street in Tulsa, Oklahoma, Blacks really supporting themselves and Black owned and build Black and give Black. So give back, give Black. I hope that during this month of Black Philanthropy Month, that you'll look at this as an opportunity to support businesses, scholarships, the churches that have suffered greatly, and other nonprofits that are here to help and serve. Additionally, I attend a lot of webinars myself. I was on a UC Berkeley webinar that I attended, I guess about 2 weeks ago, and they gave this amazing stat that out of the $12 billion that's been given since January 2020, close to $8 billion focus on balancing the equity gap with funding focused on underserved racial equity and education. I mean, amazing. You know, I mentioned some of the big players in that space, you know, that we all kind of know at this point. But almost 90% of foundations are making new efforts to support organizations serving communities adversely affected by public health and economic consequences caused by COVID and causing the systematic racism that are targeting, of course, primarily Blacks, Latinos, and lower income communities. So the time and the tide has shifted. The time has said that we really need to rebalance some things and we really haven't focused on as a society. And COVID truly painted a clear picture of the social and racial injustice of healthcare systems that also had major implications on our financial system. So it is now, and it's truly an interesting opportunity of a new day and a new way that we all can galvanize behind a new thing that is in this marketplace. I truly hope it continues. Yes, yes, yes. But this puts nonprofits in a different place that you all have to think differently. The landscape is so very new. These three yeses of this presentation will help you focus on partnership negotiations that you'll be having or already are having, focusing on going deeper with impact. So I will go ahead and jump in. And remember, if you do have any questions, go ahead and put them in the chat. And during the end of this session, Christina will read the questions and we'll just come off of mute and talk that through. So the three yeses of $1 million deals. Drum roll, yes. There are three key yeses that must be met to increase your odds of a more lasting strategic partnership that's just not about funding. It's really more about growing brand, creating shared value, and even positioning for your board. I know we all have noticed that some organizations and fundraisers are just more successful than others, and you can't really seem to figure out why. You even seen some of your colleagues in action and you're like, how does it come so easy for them? You know, my colleagues used to say, I don't get it. You just say a couple of things and they're like, yes. And I'm like, no. There's a whole lot of preparation that goes into saying a couple of things and then saying yes. And so we'll talk about what those things are here. So while there's no magic pill to being great, there is preparation that definitely sets the stage in your favor. And I know we've all heard for generations that, you know, you got to prepare, you got to do your research. But somehow we've missed the marks on key preparation for partnership development and negotiations. And in my over 25 years of leading, I have seen and discovered these three key yeses that must be met to increase those odds for lasting relationships. Now, I will also say in the next, I guess, 30 minutes, we will explore these core yeses and provide those tools and nuggets for how you can approach prospecting and client partnership development with a mindset shift. So let's go ahead and jump in. The first yes is the alignment yes. And there's some other slides in here that we will I'll show a bit more about this. This is the blueprint of the backgrounder. This is truly understanding the client and the organization that you are working with. This must be in place before you even pick up the phone. This must be in place in order to validate your prospecting. So we'll talk about that, because it's not that simple, like, oh yeah, they give to this and we do this and let's move forward. It's not that simple. And we'll talk about some examples of what that is. Then there's the ideation, yes, my personal favorite, where you're like the puppet master of the deal. You're really creating an opportunity for not only have they already bought from you, they bought the organization, but now they're actually buying that widget, gidget, gadget that you're wanting to sell, and truly bringing people around the table. So there's a whole session that I teach called the art of ideation. And if you don't know what ideation is, it's like true sausage making in action. They're coming with their ideas about what their goals are. You're coming with your ideas, what your goals are. You come together and you put those ideas together so that you can then create something more meaningful of, you can create something more meaningful together. And that's really that sausage making opportunity that happens with the art of ideation. And then there is the proposal process, where the clients are asking you for the proposal. So I'll jump right on in. So the alignment, yes. I have to say, well, actually, before I get here, let me see the expertise level on who's in this session. Because as I mentioned, these sessions can be between 1 and 3 days. So I'm going to launch another poll. And I need to see, launch. Am I working with some novice who are in the $25,000 to $250,000 range, more intermediate, up to $500,000, you know, six figures, or heck, you're an expert. You could really just do this on your own. And you already have this, and you should be training together. So tell me who I am here. I see an expert. Yes. I love that. Okay. Good, good, good. Yep. All right, good. So while you're putting that in, as I'm thinking through what I need to share, you know, this formula that I created really spans years of trial and error. It really is. It is about what I've read, research, listening to clients, taking time to understand people. Mm-hmm. Yes, because again, people buy from people first. The company, their ideas, industry trends, and what's a big vision that might exist in the marketplace? What's that systems change that might exist in the marketplace? So good. We have a good spread of people from novice to experts. So that is great. Thank you so much for that. So newsflash, if I could just say one thing. All right, let me go ahead and admit more people. 80% of nonprofits sell incorrectly. You sell a product, you sell a program, you sell a widget, a gidget, or a gadget. But the art of a deal says that people buy from people first, the organization second, and the product is last. People buy from people first. So let's take the analogy of dating, since so many people are like, oh, you know, it's so hard to ask people for money. I'm like, it's just relationships. So you're going on a date with someone. You're getting to know them as an individual. And then if it grows, you get to know their family and their friends, the organization. And then you kind of know if you're dating a 1-carat versus a 10-carat person. You kind of know what you're doing on that point. So that's kind of the ideation of if this works and how we're going to get together. And then at that point, you're selling a product. So again, you have to think about this as a one-to-one relationship building with an individual first. It's like my first calls, I'm not selling anything. I just want to know if you're even a good partner for me or if I'm a good partner for you. So an example, I was one of my larger million-dollar clients is a healthcare provider that's on the West Coast. And after a couple of meetings on the phone and maybe 2 or 3 meetings in person on a third meeting, she announced to me Diana, I wanna, you know, fund and invest. Prior to this, all I've been doing is throwing spaghetti on walls, like, what if? Imagine if. Wouldn't it be great if? How about we consider something that could? Because at that point, I was pretty much sharing impact that we have with other donors and partners, sharing a feeling and a sense of who we are as an organization so that they could get a sense of not only me, but the organization itself. And in that third meeting, she announced, Diana, I want to invest $1 million into your organization. I don't know what we're going to do with it, but I know based on what you do and your partnerships and the organization that we are going to do something great together. Now, of course, I did my happy dance. I think I moved too fast back. All right, 1 second. Of course, I did my happy dance. Of course, I was like, oh my God, I got $1 million. Yay, I get to take this back. But it really edified the selling process. It really edified that people do buy from people first. And yes, I've had a couple of these since. It's not every day, let's be clear. If it was, we all would be doing things very differently. But it really is talking about almost the McKinsey model, you know, Jeff Bezos' ex-wife, where she is investing in organizations that are serving core needs with no strings attached. We definitely need more of those in the world, let's be clear. So, as I mentioned, you know, there are some wonderful examples of people literally shaping relationships with this first before you buy a product. And so I will go ahead and jump into the psychology of the deal. So we are focusing on the alignment, yes. The backgrounder is truly the partnership blueprint. It is the know before you go. And I'll show you an example of what that looks like. This document is used to level set the intentions internally so that your team understands what they are doing and who they are speaking to and how to sell to them. You know, it really is, you're literally studying a client. You're becoming almost as if you work there. You know, you're studying them collectively, like where's the organization going, value that they have in the marketplace, any mergers, acquisitions, you know, what market share that they're trying to acquire, but you're also studying the person individually. This document explores multiple areas to determine not only if you're aligned, but the prioritization of you talking to them. It's used to level set, as I mentioned, and understand who you're speaking to and how to sell to them. So if you know that they have a law degree, you're talking to them a different way. If they have an education degree, then you're talking to them a different way. So it really is the tool that must be used for all of your clients and partners. We explore such things as, you know, who do they fund and recent news, outreach tactics, what language do they use, what industry terms do they use, who should be on the initial calls on the setups, and who are those decision makers. But these are about 4 bullets of something that is much more in depth. And I'll go over a little bit of that, and then I will give you a visual of what that actually looks like. So, you know, yes, you want to study your client collectively and individually, as I mentioned, but this is where you find out if they're right brain, if they're left brain. You know, who are you speaking to? What are their drivers? Who are their influencers? Who do they fund? What are they missing? Are you that unlikely partner that they have been looking for? You know, who's on their board? Are there connections to your board? What geographies do they cover? If they're national, great. If they're not national, will they even work with you and talk to you? Outreach. There's so much done before you even outreach, but the main thing is, who is the person that you're targeting? Who is that number one person that is a decision maker or a thread to a lot of people in the organization? So that takes a little bit of research. Are they quoted? Where are they quoted? What language do they use? What industry terms? What matters to them? And invite not only them, but their team members. So again, you're wanting to invite those decision makers on to the call. The internal meeting, which is usually a phone meeting first, you must be prepared. I have heard so many grant-making organizations tell me how, and you know, unfortunately we talk about it over drinks sometimes, tell me how ill-prepared nonprofits are when they make those calls. So you must be prepared. You know, again, that backgrounder is your blueprint on how you're going to talk to that funding entity. But as they're inviting more people on that call, you want to know the backgrounds of every single person on that call, because there has to be mutual balance of partnerships. So if they have a researcher or a data somebody on that call, you need to have a researcher on your call. If they have a chief information officer or somebody on the IT side, you have to have that person likewise, because you don't want to get caught with people not valuing the time that they had when they were speaking with you. So there must be alignment. Always, 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 always have them speak first, because the information that you see on the website is dated. Most organizations, especially on the philanthropic side, do not keep their information updated. So you need to know the most relevant information that you can have, and that comes from their mouth. You know, so when you set up that agenda, always have them talk first. And then you want to mirror how they talk. If you're talking to someone who is fast and about statistics, speak fast and talk about statistics. If you're talking to someone who is a little slow and she's more about stories, or he's more about stories of impact, and you know, in Dinwiddie County, Virginia, we've done this. You want to mirror that way of talking, because people hear, and well, hear, people hear how they talk faster than how you talk. So there's a whole psychology on that. But at the end of the day, having the right people on that phone and in that meeting will reduce the number of meetings you have to get to that yes or to get to that no. So I'm going to share, I'm going to stop sharing this screen, and I'm going to switch over to sharing what a backgrounder actually looks like, so that you understand the depth and breadth of what I'm talking about as it concerns what you need to know before you even talk to someone. So I've made up a National Council Foundation. I would say that's us. And then Big Bank Foundation, a financial entity. These are actually real people that work for an organization. This is an old backgrounder, but I've left some of the information in here. So I know Kimberly's background. I know how long she's been there. I know that she has a political science degree. So the reason I put their education in there is to know if there's any connections, to know if, you know, if I went there, we can say, oh, go blue, go this, whatever. But also who the decision maker is. Her boss is really the decision maker. So, but I also know that they oversee an annual grant of $40 million. And there's another pot of money of $22 million from corporate contributions. So I know that they have money. And then we have the purpose of the call. You know, and again, if Lara has a law degree, I know she wants facts and figures quickly. Okay. So again, you got to mirror their background based on people buy from people first. So I need to be somebody that she can buy from. The purpose, always put that in there to discuss this, that, and the other. And then these areas, basic needs, building assets, connecting people to quality jobs and transforming communities, are their pillars. So what I put in green is where we match the most. And I color coordinate so that when I'm talking to them, I have this open, my team has this open, and we all know what the relevant pieces that we must edify on those calls in order to get them to say, yeah, I'm interested in having another conversation, inviting more people. So we meet on their basic needs the most. However, we also have some alignment on building assets. And you always want to say where you match and what you're doing on the matching side, so you have those team members around the table. So again, as I'm talking to them, the green are the things that I want to focus on as I'm, again, using their language when I am selling or relationship building with them. So background, corporate giving, impact investment, you name it. Geographic areas, so if you're in Kansas City, that's a no. However, if you're in any of those or a national organization, it's a yes. This is an older a backgrounder, so it's 2015 where they gave $37 million. But since I'm a big game fisher woman, I like, you know, the high sixes and the millions. So how am I going to get there? Knowing that they give this amount, you would think that, oh boy, they're definitely giving out lots of million-dollar grants. Not really. Their average grant size is between $200,000 and $300,000. But their highest that year was $2 million to the Rockefeller Philanthropy Advisors, which is a whole different concept, as we all know. So I need to see, like, what other areas that they've given to that are even in my realm of what I consider a good dating partner. Again, I'm more of a 10-care girl. And then what agenda, the key questions that I would have, and then the roles of my team as far as a general agenda. And I use this as a living, breathing document. So I have my notes in there from my meeting, on and on. So this is just a sample of what a backgrounder looks like, so that you are fully aware of who you're talking to, where you fit, how to talk to them. So I know that was a lot of information, no doubt. But the level setting and the information sharing across the organization to make sure that your teams are informed will reduce the number of meetings that you have with the client so that you can get to the yes or the no faster. So I really want to stress the importance of what this really could be for your organization. You know, this is, you know, with these backgrounders, you might have thought that they're in your top 10, but then you look at it and you're like, oh my God, it's gonna take a lot of work to work with this entity. No, we're going to put them closer to 20, maybe even 25, or the reverse. They are so primed right now for what you're doing that you want to target them immediately. So yes, this document is your blueprint of the partnership. It tells you everything you need to know, and if they're a good dating partner and vice versa. And it should be done with every current client you have, to create a roadmap expansion plan, and every client that you have on your top 20 list. This is a living, breathing document that needs to be updated regularly and to be shared with your leadership. And I know we have Salesforce and they're like, yeah, I'm gonna go on Salesforce and get that data and information. This is a little different because I know with working with leaders across the spectrum, not everybody is going in Salesforce and finding out all the wonderful data. So this is a quick cheat sheet for leaders and the people working on that partnership that they can have that orders how they talk to the partner as well. If you make this a habit, it will transform how you do business and increase your ratio, hands down. As I also mentioned, this is a lot, yes, and it normally takes about a day or a session to go through just this part of effective backgrounders and then also negotiating what they look like. But I just wanted to make sure that you see all that goes into it before you even pick up the phone to talk to a partner. All right, I'll keep going. Okay, the ideation. All right. This is my personal favorite, I have to say. I just love ideation. You know, a successful ideation is truly the gorilla glue of framing a long-term partnership. Artful ideation is not just a meeting, but it's becoming like the orchestrator of the psychology of the deal. It's like a dance. Like, you planted the seeds in your initial meeting with your prospect. They've already purchased, you know, they already bought you. They see you and your team as credible, smart, engaging, knowledgeable about who they are and what they want. But they also bought the organization. So this is really to explore like the alignment, the true alignment, and really to create the partnership roadmap. So overall, it's a well-orchestrated event of roles and responsibilities. and specific stories designed for all participating attendees. It is specifically designed for all participating attendees. So again, if they have, different folks from the different areas of their organization, you know, they have technologists, they have a data folk, they have, you know, a community activist, they have all the different pieces, you're also marrying your pieces with them so that they have collective energy of building partnerships with like-minded people. I will say this, if they have two people and you have seven, that's a problem, okay? You have to match with match. You can have three, maybe even four, but definitely not seven. And I'm a firm believer that if they're around the table, they have something to say. So if you have folks that are not talking, they don't need to be in the room unless they're taking notes or you've already announced that this is a person in training, okay? But if they are saying something, it must be of credible substance, meaning that if they only have two or three bullets, give those two or three bullets to somebody else and they can say it and they can read the notes later. Because what you're wanting to create is the right ratio of connected energy, the feeling and the vibes of, yeah, we want to do this. Because you already have a deep understanding of the decision makers and their pain points, but this meeting edifies even more. Like, who is doing what? What's the ratio of who talks the most in the room? You know, you should have that up front of like knowing like who's going to say what. But in that meeting, you know, whether it's a Zoom version or Google Meet version or in-person version, you'll begin to dissect who, what, when, where, and how. You'll also be able to pivot in real time. And as that puppet master, you own this process. You own how everything is activated. So I'm going to, Christina, if you could show what an external agenda looks like, and then we'll compare that to an internal agenda. Yes. I really want you all to see.
I was just saying yes, I'll bring that right up.
Okay, great. So I really want you to see how I prep externally as well as how I prep internally. So again, using the same organization, National Council Foundation, I have our meeting participant, I have my team on this meeting. Now, I always start with the introduction of roles and responsibility and the vision for the partnership, okay? Then I, again, as I mentioned before, always have them speak first. These agendas are co-created together. This is not an agenda that I'm just sending to them and saying, this is how we're gonna meet. No ma'am, no ham, no turkey. This is an agenda that's co-created together so that they're saying, okay, Diana, we wanna talk about our ad campaign. We wanna talk about, you know, what actions we have for older adults or their target demographic or population. I always put in their current partners, outcome, and missing pieces so that I can have a general understanding. You can stop right there. That's good. Thank you, Christina. Again, after they speak, we speak. And then that's when we have the conversions of assets. And then ideation actually happens. So this is what I would call a short agenda. This is more of a 2 to 3 hour ideation. But the one thing that I always have up front during introduction roles and responsibilities is the vision for the partnership. Let me tell you why. Though you want them to speak first, and that is the right thing to do, you want to color the lines before they speak. For instance, I always kick off. I'm looking for a partnership that will impact the lives of 1 million older adults so that they have better economic security moving forward and they are prepared before, during, and after retirement with key programs, tactics, and outcomes. My Bob, my VP of technology, would say, and adding on to what Diana says, and to have a technology system that is the go-to system that older adults want to connect themselves to. And then Mary, being on director of economic security, will say, and that we have relevant partners in the marketplace. So that's the vision. Millions of people connected that know where to go, a technology solution, and partnerships in place. Then they talk. So just note that you set the vision first in a very casual way of loftiness, and then they respond likewise. All right, so take this one out and put in the internal agenda. So the internal agenda is different. And there's two versions of an internal agenda. There's a short version and the long version. I'm only going to show the short version of this one. The short version says who speaks, and it's color-coded. So for instance, Bob knows that he's speaking in two sections. Mary knows she's speaking in one section. So with partnership vision, everybody talks. I'll say, you know, the quick version, no more than 5 minutes, you know, for everybody. But this really is color-coded based on the amount of data that people share. So there's another version of this. So as I mentioned, my vision, 1 million people doing, Bob's vision, technology solutions. So under that would have those things in there so that we could then, under introduction, roles and responsibilities, partnership vision, it would have that in there. Or with Mary doing economic casework, I want to know what story she's using to make sure that if this organization, Big Bank Foundation, wants to have more market share and making it up Baltimore or Louisiana or Minneapolis, that we're using stories from those areas, okay? Thanks, Marlene. Thanks, Ana Rosa. I know you have to go. We're using stories from those areas so that I then know what those stories are so that I can edify that with the exclamation points and so forth. And I want to know what Bob's slides will be so that I can make sure that we're all on the same page of how we're going to present. So we can come out of that, and I'll go back to my window. Okay, thank you, Christina.
You're welcome.
So all of this orchestration happens before you even meet, okay? That's what I've been saying for years. It's all about the preparation that leads to the outcomes that you want. So once this happens, and if done well, they're already coming to this meeting saying yes, because they've already bought this interaction with smart, like-minded people around the table. The organization has credibility in the marketplace, and now they're ready to buy the widget, gadget, or gadget that we want. All right, so we're bringing it home with the third yes. Advancing. The proposal. I know, y'all like, God bless, we're just now getting here? Yes, it takes a lot of work just to get to this point. But here's the biggest takeaway, you know, and hand raise. How many of you all leave a big meeting and it's been going great, and everybody scurries around talking about, oh my God, we have a potential $1 million partner. You know, everybody's just jumping around. Stop it. Stop. I've seen this go so many sideways wrong, where everybody's trying to add their 50,000 or $250,000 piece into a proposal, and it's usually coming from the C-suites. Mm-hmm. Where y'all are just trying to like milk it for everything you have. In that presentation, in that ideation, you might have thought that everybody agreed on the 1, 2, 3. But after your partner goes back and meets internally, and they get more people to buy in, more people to think about, because now they're an advocate for the partnership, they may come back with a 2, 3, 1 as far as their prioritization. So hold off on presenting a proposal until you have agreement on, you're welcome, Suzanne. You have an agreement on what it looks like. So don't look at all of the other, you know, fly arounds. But no, let me be clear. You do need to do the work to make sure that you know what the pieces from your ideation. Like, yes, these are the core pieces. Everybody, you know, give me your core pieces. And you've already qualified the numbers. You already know if they're the 1 carat or 10 carat partner. They already know if you're 1 carat or 10 carat partner. You know, you already have all this, but this is when you just put a vision in front of them, a vision that encompasses everything that they said in that meeting and everything that you've said, the highlights of it. You know, the 1 million and the technology solutions and impacting community. a multi-year effect, tangible tactics, and a range. This is 1 million to 4 million multi-year. But if I could just say one thing, first, write an outline to stop the 40% churn that happens in an organization when a big donor is on the hook or any donor is on the hook. Write an outline so everybody truly understands what is going to go into this proposal and to get buy-in before you actually write it. So I won't belabor that point any longer because I do want to leave some time for questions. So I know I've shared a lot of information, and I do want you to share this with your leadership teams, your boards, your development, your program team, because at this point, it is a new day, a new way of philanthropy and giving and impacting communities. So share this information. I will be sharing this deck and this link for others. Thank you very much, Kia. And I hope you take away one or two nuggets that can help you think through your process differently. Because if we can add more in the beginning and take the time in the beginning, we will reduce staff time and churn on the end. And that's really what this is all about. This has really allowed me to successfully impact 20 million lives of youth and adults across my career and successfully secure over $500 million, this formula. So I know that this is a 45-minute version to something that, as I said, is like a day to 3 day of a workshop. But I hope this tool provides you a platform and provides you some nuggets on how you can do things differently. I'm offering a free 45-minute assessment call of how you can either change your mindset or, tactics to cracking the ceiling with your partners. Because I am here to lift all boats. And if I can have my megaphone out of trying to make sure that organizations are prepared for this new philanthropic world even more than they are, that would be great. So I will pause there for questions and to see if anybody has any questions. Hand raise, okay. Let me see. Yes, hold on, open queue. Kia, you wanna come off of mute?
Yeah, thank you for this presentation. And I particularly appreciate seeing what the flow looks like, how you manage internal expectations. And I would venture that in doing this, you've had the experience where you've had the successful ideation meeting and the entity that, you're courting comes back with, some new angles or new strategy, right? Absolutely. They've met and they're like, we are all in. Mm-hmm. And we mm-hmm. want to do this.
Right.
Right. They right. might want to do even above and beyond what was conceived. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I just think that it's really important managing internal, ideas and politics. And mm-hmm. I know that you're a straight shooter, very straight shooter, very honest. How do you deal with, folks that have these grandiose ideas or folks that want to lock and load and kind of deviate? Like, how do you, because I've been told I'm a little abrupt sometimes, how do you just kind of get people to kind of, follow the script, if you will?
Right. That takes, during the preparation of all of this, all the level set meetings that go into before we even meet, especially senior leaders, the C-suite, having them ask the questions and think through their things up front, being informed throughout the process and making sure that you're clear with them on, what this is, what they want. They've been a part of the process. So it really is that internal sales that needs to happen. Of why that backgrounder and that process of internal level setting is so important. So by the time they get to this point, they trust you and they trust what you have to say. And you have the client's voice in your head. You know that client, you've spoken to that client, they're on those calls too. So it really is that push and pull that happens, because it still happens. It still is like, oh my God, we can throw in the $250,000 for a conference. And I'm like, they don't want conference. But that's interesting to talk about. Thank you. What else do we have? So I try to negotiate it based on, let's go back to the blueprint of the backgrounder. Let's go back to the meeting notes. Let's go back to the outcome documents and focus on that. And then really kind of push it and then say, you know what, that's great. Maybe we can add that later after we finish this part. That's a great addition to building the partnership moving forward. So I push for the partnership. I push for outcomes that drive that yes in between and not just what we want from them. So that's a little tactics that I take. Okay. I saw another hand.
Kim? Mm-hmm. to grow Kia's example, what if you have done all the research that she mentioned, you come to the table and you realize I'm just gonna have to give you a real example.
Yeah.
So there is a partner that I'm working with who is now growing into the diversity, growing their diversity inclusion space,
mm-hmm.
as we speak, current with the times. So because that is a whole new sort of division and strategy for them, it's not new to us. I'm presenting the strategy for them. This is how you want to make impact in this area. Mm-hmm. It makes sense to me, but because they haven't even internally worked it out, and they have a proposal in front of them and have mutually agreed on, this is where we want to have impact. What would you advise me to do as far as next steps?
Mm-hmm.
Because again, their vision is not even solidified, it seems, and they need time to kind of build internally.
I have two clients just like that. As I mentioned early on this call, Pinnacle Talent Acquisition, and I definitely want to thank them. I know folks might have to jump off, but thank you again, Pinnacle Talent Acquisition, for supporting this webinar. But I have partnered with organizations that help with this DEI work. There's a lot that needs to be done. There's internal cultural work. There's level setting on inclusiveness and how an organization functions, you know, adding to their culture. And I have a couple clients that are going through that process now. But then when they come on the other side of it, and how I've been talking to them is about now what? Now, how do we then activate that into a tangible plan? Do we look at your giving criteria and your guidelines to make them more inclusive? I notice that you don't give to any organization under a certain budget amount. However, those are the ones that need it the most. You know, philanthropy is balancing the equity gap. Uh-huh. So I'm working with them to think through what are the one or two things that they could do. And then my communication with them is like, okay, where are you on your process of internal man, woman in the mirror, you know, looking at that Harvard University study of, you know yourself and to know your biases, check your biases. You know, I've been a big proponent of that so that people can really understand who they are and then how that impacts their grant making. But, you know, Kim, we could probably have another conversation about this offline. Love to, you know, talk to you about what you're doing and to see how I can possibly tweak along the way, how you can be more effective with them as they go along this uncharted journey and possibly bringing in another firm to help them figure out how to manage this. I'm working with Rolls-Royce Automation, and they're going through a whole DEI resurgence. And I'm like, y'all not in the marketplace. You all made no statements. You all did nothing for George Floyd. You're like nothing. So what do you really want to do? Is it just a stamp? And if it's so, okay. But don't do this alone. Let's bring in a team to help you with this. And I know we have 1 minute left. And I just want to say, and Danielle, I hope to get to you in a second. There's another session coming next week on the 25th of Why Philanthropy is Failing. Please share that one, come to that one so that you can understand what I'm talking to as far as the grant making organizations. And there's these five tactics that are cost neutral, that you can do with your partners. And for those that do need to jump off, thank you so much for joining. I will be sharing this presentation with you. And if you have a little more time, Danielle, what's your question? Danielle?
I'm sorry, can you hear me?
Yes, I can now.
Hi. Yes, listen, Diana, this was a phenomenal presentation. Thank you for including me. One question for you. If there are other people who I believe need to hear this, should I send you their names? How can we support
Absolutely.
You?
Absolutely, thank you. Okay. So yes, this is something, again, I'm trying to lift all boats here so that we can all ride this wave together. Please share my information, share my link, share anything about me.
Okay.
You know, really most of my clients are from referrals. There I am right there. Most of my clients are from referrals and people kind of talking to one another about sure. what I'm doing. Sure. And then I come in and talk about what they could be moving forward.
Okay. We'll do on that. And just one thing I wanted to compliment you on, and I'm sorry, my phone won't let me share my camera, even though I am camera ready today. I think it speaks to the question that one of the previous people asked. You have a very good way of assessing the room. There's an instance where I could have been in the room, I should have been in the room. And after the fact, you know, you brought up to the CEO, to the decision makers, like, where is your person who I know is involved in a particular area? And, you know, to the other woman that asked about moving forward DEI, you know, initiatives, even if you can't break through, I just thought that was masterful. And it really did resonate on the back end. And I know you know what I'm talking about. Sometimes we, you know, through all your research, and the backgrounder that you did, there are just so many ways to use that to your advantage.
Absolutely. And those backgrounders are there to know who should be in the room. The backgrounders, when you have an inclusive culture, and that's right. kind of what organizations are going through right now.
Right.
As I mentioned, you know, Pinnacle Talent does a lot of that work with, you know, diversity inclusion audits. Creating that inclusive culture is really how you're going to maximize your biggest asset, which is your employees. Everybody knows that. However, how to do it and getting organizations to sign up for it to actually go through the work is a challenge, because people have just, they haven't known, they haven't done, they, it's just business as usual, and they're fine with how they've been functioning. And now we are doing something differently.
Right.
Yes, it is sometimes a little harder, especially before the inclusive movement, to get double dutched onto in the
right.
meeting to make sure that you're there at the table.
Right. But
I definitely have talked to organizations about level set meetings mm-hmm. and all the partners who have pieces of a pie to determine who should be in that presentation meeting.
Sure. And it's not necessarily just by title.
No,
either.
It is
sometimes
not.
It's by relationship.
Not at all. My sure. relationship and my content expertise. So.
Right. Well, thank you so much for this again. I thought it was great.
Absolutely.
All the best to you.
Well, thank you again, everyone. I know we're way over time. Several people have had to jump off. Thank you. Let's connect offline and have a wonderful day and a great weekend.